Hi, let's talk about some heart pathologies and interventions. So the first pathology I'd like to discuss is a patent foramen ovale. So during in utero gestation, the interatrial septum has two parts or two septa. There's a primary and a secondary septum. These septa are slightly unopposed, and so there is an opening between these two septa referred to as the foramen ovale or the oval window. At birth, these two septa snap together and the foramen ovale is therefore obliterated. In a minority of cases, the foramen ovale remains patent or open and blood can travel between the left and right atria. So this is a short circuiting of the pulmonary loop. Oxygen poor blood from systemic circulation flows from the right atrium into the left atrium and then is redistributed through the systemic loop. More often than not, a PFO is subclinical, and if it's small enough, it probably goes unnoticed for a person's lifetime. If they're large enough, or if the person is involved in activities that require, you know, a great deal of pressure upon the heart, such as deep sea diving, etc., then maybe there should be a fix to it. But largely, a PFO is going to be subclinical. The next pathology is a hemopericardium. So a hemopericardium is a type of pericardial effusion or the presence of a substance within the pericardial cavity. And in the case of hemopericardium, that substance is blood. Now, in this case, the flowing of blood into that pericardial cavity is going to lead to a condition known as cardiac tamponade. This is pressure upon the heart itself, and it prevents the heart from fully expanding during diastole, which is going to interfere with heart function and can ultimately be deadly. So in this case, the blood here within the pericardial cavity has coagulated and has been plastinated along with this specimen, which is quite remarkable. The next pathology that I'd like you to see is an aortic valve calcification. Aortic valve calcifications are a common pathway for aortic valvular disease. So we can tell that we're looking at an aortic valve because I can see coronary arteries coming out of this area. And normally these cusps are quite smooth, but we can see some of these calcifications on the cusps here. Sometimes these calcifications can prevent the valves from fully opposing one another, and so there might be regurgitation. And in some cases, the calcifications can fuse the valves together and lead to a condition known as aortic valve stenosis. And that stenosis really is going to limit the amount of blood that flows out of the left ventricle and into the aorta, both causing, an oxygen deficit in metabolically active tissues, but also dramatically increasing blood pressure and leading to ventricular hypertrophy. And then finally, an intervention. So coronary artery disease is typically caused by atherosclerotic plaque, which narrows the lumen of either a coronary artery or one of its branches. One intervention for coronary artery disease would be a coronary artery bypass graft, or CABG for short. A CABG is when a donor vessel is harvested. So it could be the great saphenous vein. It could be the radial artery, or it could be an internal thoracic artery. Anywhere that there is good collateral blood flow enables a surgeon to evaluate a vessel for harvesting for grafting. And what happens is a suitable source of blood, in this case and in many others, the ascending aorta is chosen, and a graft is sutured to that source of blood, and then the graft runs distally to wherever the occlusion is found to resume the flow of blood to the remainder of that coronary artery and its branches. So there may be a single, a double, a triple, a quadruple, a quintuple bypass graft, and the number of bypasses, curiously enough, don't typically, but they may, alter the prognosis. And generally, these bypass grafts are very successful, allowing people to resume their normal activities, hopefully with improvement of diet and exercise. Thank you very much for your time.